So hello everyone, and this is Ritu Maurya joining you live on the budget review for budget 2021. Indeed, a very short budget, probably one of the shortest I have ever seen in the history of budgets being presented in India. But of course, the finance minister, Mrs. Nirmala Sitharaman, she kept it quite wonderful, and she also kept it quite vibrant, and has also promised a great and lot more for this country, as she has given SOPs, which will help a lot of financial and capital expenditures to be made, which will further lead to great capital employment generation in this country, and also lead to a lot many investments being made by other sectors, which could be from real estate to manufacturing. And of course, Make in India got a very, very large push in this particular budget, and therefore we would see greater manufacturing happen in India, and also India becoming a large manufacturing hub. So today we joined first by Mr. Siddharth Pai, who is the partner on 314 Capital, and is going to sort of share with us as to what the budget did for the startups and overall for the economy, what is expected out of coming out of this budget. We're also joined by our editors, Punita and Saurabh, who will be asking questions. So in case you have questions, either on Facebook Live or on Zoom, please feel free to ask, and we will get our experts to answer them for you. So Siddharth, let me start by asking you, what do you think about the budget? How are you going to rate it? Any sort of out of 20, how are you going to sort of give? What numbers are you going to give to it? And also to say that, you know, particularly for startups, the budget has been, budget has seen some forthcomings. And how do you rate this budget, and how do you see it panning out for startups in the coming year?
I think overall, Ritu, on a scale of 1 to 20, I'll actually rate this budget as being about 16%. I think one of the biggest pros of this budget is the fact that the budget hasn't actually introduced any new cesses or any new taxes besides the small agricultural tax or petrol and a few other aspects. Because despite the stock market actually booming, a large portion of the company, a large portion of the country is still actually struggling in terms of cash flows itself, and business is yet to actually resume back as of now. So any new introduction of taxes would have actually been severely burdensome upon the entire country. And I'm very glad to see that the government actually managed to increase expenditure on healthcare, increase expenditure on infrastructure and CapEx, as well as education, without resorting to the need to actually go and raise and impose fresh taxes upon the entire populace. I think that's been one of the biggest strong points of this entire budget. The budget itself has also actually articulated the stance of the government in various other regards. The fact that the increase in expenditure in terms of healthcare and education, these are two sectors where startups are actually going to see, have seen a large amount of buoyancy over the past 3 to 4 years, especially edtech since the beginning of the lockdown. And we should see with these particular charges coming in place, as well as the fact that the government doesn't want to do everything by itself, but actually wants to start partnering with the private sector on this, will actually augur very well for Indian startups in both these particular sections and both these particular sectors also. Overall, for the entire startups, I think the two biggest changes the startups have seen is the fact that the tax holiday for in terms of 3 out of 10 years, the income tax holiday for startups has been extended by a period of 1 year, as well as the fact that any investment into a startup, the tax break that accompanies that has also been extended by a year itself. However, I must actually underscore the fact that the existing issues in terms of actually giving the IMB certification for both these particular sections hasn't actually been addressed by the finance minister so far. This has been one of the biggest issues in the entire thing, because as per DPIT, there are only about 400 startups out of 50,000 startups in the country who are actually eligible for these two particular sections. And the biggest pain point of here is the fact there's a group of bureaucrats who actually has to sit and certify you as being innovative in order for you to actually avail of this. Yes. This means that the bureaucracy believes there are only 400 innovative startups in the entire country out of 50,000 startups, which actually underserves the entire market as a whole. And hopefully with the rise of the National Startup Advisory Council, they should actually see someone to reform in this particular thing over the next year, and startups should actually see a lot more buoyancy in that regard. Because, Ritu, I must underscore the fact that the Honorable Prime Minister actually expects startups in the innovation economy to contribute $1 trillion by the year 2025. In order for this, we're going to start seeing a lot more investment into innovation. We're going to see even India requires a lot more tax breaks in order to start incentivizing investments into startups. One more point I think that actually augurs well for the entire investing industry, especially startups, as well as private equity as a whole, is the fact that the government is now allowed for funds that have been domiciled in either Mauritius or Singapore, any of the other jurisdictions, to actually move to GIFT City IFSC without having to pay any tax. This will be a huge boost for a number of them, because this will essentially help onshore the offshore, which has been a flagship project of the IDCA, Indian Venture Capital Association, and others itself. This will help create a much more stronger and vibrant fund ecosystem and fund management ecosystem within the country. And hopefully in some time, we may no longer need the likes of Mauritius and other stepping stones into Indian equities, that foreign investors can directly take a position in Indian equities without having to resort to intermediate jurisdictions for this. And the moment that starts happening, that's the biggest voucher confidence for foreign capital coming into the country. And this budget has actually done a master stroke in enabling that to happen so far.
Sure. No, that's a wonderful framework that you have built over there. But, you know, since you mentioned that it's a great budget for healthcare, and I think the layout overall has increased substantially this year. So what do you see panning out for healthcare startups in India? Do you see something as big or a rocket change happening just like it happened for EdTech during the pandemic?
No, it will. It will. Because, see, I think one of the biggest portions that's coming out in healthcare as of now is the fact that the Bharat Health Stack, which is similar to what Aadhaar actually did for fintech and payments and everything, will actually start coming into vogue and start being utilized by the government sometime soon. And that actually becomes one of the strongest points, because once that strong foundation, the technology framework is actually built, startups can actually start building products and services on top of this entire portion, on top of this entire platform itself. And similar to what we've seen happen with UPI, the startups can actually become the ambassadors for this when it comes to healthcare. That becomes number one. Number two, I think e-pharmacies and the e-commerce model when it comes to delivering medicines, which is something that faced a large amount of regulatory scrutiny just before the pandemic, has actually sort of been baptized by the entire government as of now. And they become key enablers in ensuring that people no longer have to step out to a physical pharmacy in order to get their medicines. I think that continuation will actually go a long way in increasing the adoption of e-pharmacies as a business model across various startups. That becomes number two. And number three, the fact that the government is now concentrating on increasing physical infrastructure in a public-private model as well. And with the rise of a new healthcare regulator, which we hopefully should be seeing happen during the course of this year, healthcare startups are actually poised to have the sort of same edtech moment that they had previously. And this, coupled with manufacturing, will actually go a long way in ensuring, and Make in India as well, will go a long way in ensuring that your costly MRI machines, X-ray machines, and everything can actually now start being indigenized in India itself, and Indian startups can actually go a long way in actually selling those particular products to these new healthcare ecosystem that's just being seeded as of now. So it's a cocktail of factors that's actually going to boost the entire ecosystem. What we're awaiting from the government now, and especially from the government of health as well, from the Ministry of Health, are the finer points and the guidelines behind all this, before so that startups can start working towards actualizing all this in the future as well.
Sure. Punita?
So, Siddharth, I mean, as an investor, you feel that this budget has not outlived your expectations on the capital gains?
I think the fact that the budget didn't introduce any new taxes or tinker or anything in light of COVID-19 is a huge boost of confidence for all investors, not just for VC investors, but in the invest in the stock market itself. You'd have seen the Sensex rise about 1,800 or 1,500 points just after the budget actually got done. Because the entire expectation was that the government would actually start taxing capital gains to a larger extent and also start mobilizing resources. The fact that the government hasn't done that is a huge positive for the entire ecosystem. That being said, as an investor into startups, the fact that the super rich surcharge has not been removed for investments into unlisted securities, the tax parity between listed and unlisted securities haven't been addressed, is still an issue. But I think that entire issue is a battle that the entire industry will actually continue to fight as time goes by as well.
Sure. We've also been joined by Reema Subramaniam from Ankur Capital. Hey. And she's going to give us some great inputs in terms of how this, particularly from a social standpoint, how this budget would bring a great deal from a clean tech industry because of the vehicle scrappage now being allowed. How do you think that is going to change, Reema? And also would love to know more about, you know, your stand on agriculture and government's new policies around agriculture that have been announced.
Absolutely. For us, you know, health tech, ed tech, fintech, agri tech are all very, very key infrastructures, areas which has been impacted by the budget. And Siddharth has covered significantly on the ed tech and the health tech. So I'm not going to go into it. I think it's great in those two spaces. The other thing is the 1,500 crores for digitization of fintech, which is, I think, going to be a great leveler, because a significant part of the next billion actually need those kind of support. So the digitization of fintech is of 1,500 crores is one great thing. The other is the agri infra push. One of the biggest stumbling blocks for our country has been the infrastructure in the agri sector. So this whole push, the CES is going to give a big boost. So today, if you look at all our startups in the agri space, are all struggling. One key thing is that lack of the infrastructure, and they can't be putting up those infrastructure all across the country. So when this is going to come up as a PPP model, I think this is going to be really great. So this is going to be give a great push to the agri startups. It's going to give a great push to fintech startups. Those are two areas that we see a big push coming in from.
Sure. Siddharth, what's your take on the fintech startups? Digital transactions are, of course, being named in the budget as one of the big priority areas. So what do you think is likely to be seen changing in the fintech startups in the coming in 2021 further?
So I think in terms of the fintech regulations, there were a number of asks in the fintech that the fintech startups actually had. I think the biggest thing they've got so far is a 1,500 crore boost that's actually going to come up, but the budgetary allocation of that, how it's going to be spent, etc., those details are awaited. But fintech startups as a whole, I think the government's also fully seized on the need for actually having fintech startups there, and the fact that they actually wanted to designate gift IFSC as a fintech hub for the entire nation. We should actually see the same boost that happened to IT and ITS services through the software technology parks of India when it was done in about the early 2000s. Similarly, these kind of structures, once they actually come up in GIFT, will actually go a long way in ensuring that Indian fintech is not just capitalized upon India, but Indian fintech can actually start being exported to the rest of the world itself. A large amount of work has been done over the past 3 to 4 years for various countries in Latin America, as well as Africa and Southeast Asia. We are adopting an Aadhaar-like kind of framework itself. And hopefully with the launch of the International Fintech Center in Gujarat under the auspices of GIFT, that Indian startups will actually have a leg up when it comes to that. And Indian startups can actually get a toehold in these particular jurisdictions where a similar blueprint is actually being enacted as of now.
Would you have liked this fintech hub to be in Bangalore instead?
I would have been delighted to actually have it in Bangalore, even in Bombay for that regard. I think the moment everyone in the industry is eagerly awaiting for GIFT IFSC to actually have an annexure either in Bombay or in Bangalore or something, it becomes easier for us to actually travel over there and to actually transact all this itself. But I think it's a work in progress. Hopefully the government takes into consideration and delivers something in the near future also.
And the fact, even if it's in Ahmedabad and, you know, it's itself is a big boost to all of us. And I mean, that starts takeoff. Yeah. I
think. Yeah.
Ahmedabad is still just one flight away. Much better than going to Mauritius or Singapore.
Very true. Very true.
Yeah. And, you know, Reema, what about your take on the clean tech side, and particularly with the scrappage of vehicles now being opened up? What difference do you see it making to the country?
Well, but, you know, the thing is that I have, and this is my initial reaction, need to get into the details, but I have mixed expectations from that, because as a country, we are a poor country, right? And so a lot of what we scrap here goes into the hinterland. So I feel that the impact of it overall may not be that great. I mean, I would still say is a fact, a lot of it will get pushed out. This is my initial reaction. Still need to understand a little bit more about that.
Sure, Saurabh.
Yeah, you know, I would want to talk about another sector which I believe is going to greatly gain from the infrastructure push that has been given is the logistics sector. So getting some reactions, you know, that if the kind of money that has been planned for infrastructure, how do you think the logistics sector is going to benefit, and especially the players, the startup players who are there? So Dima, if you can let me know.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I mean, the way you touched on it, I do think, yes, the logistics in India is, first of all, is a fact. Logistics is a very, very, you know, our infrastructure is so bad. So there's so much of inefficiencies that are there. So the moment this push goes into the infrastructure in terms of roads and terms of warehouses, I think we're going to see a big change in that. Coupled with the digitization that's happening up, this is the next big area that we are going to see in terms of startups coming in. See, the entire e-commerce, the digital commerce picking up is dependent on logistics. It's all a logistics game. At the end of it, it's logistics and credit are the two key things in the e-commerce play. And with this infrastructure push, you're going to open up. I mean, today e-commerce is just a very, very small percentage of our entire commerce. And so this is going to at least push this out in terms of opportunities for both startups, not just in logistics, but also for folks who are going to be in e-commerce or anything which is about
agri-tech for that matter.
Supply chains. Yeah, any digitization of any supply chains, all the supply chains will have a positive impact because of this.
Yeah, so that your views?
No, I think Saurabh, so the logistics cost is actually 14% of India's GDP as of now, whereas the median for the rest of the world is roughly about 6-7%. So there's a large amount of latitude that latitude of cost reduction that can actually happen in terms of logistics itself. I think GST did a long way in actually easing the flow that's happened. That dedicated freight corridors that the government is actually speaking about as of now will actually go a long way in reducing logistics costs as a whole, because rail is actually one of the lowest cost means of inland logistics transports around. And the fact that the railways have actually placed a larger precedence, a larger premium on the passage of passengers as opposed to goods has actually adversely affected the revenues of the railway for a long period of time. The fact that the railways, ever since the lockdown happened, have started using excess carriage space to actually start transporting agricultural goods, which has been a huge boost for the agricultural sector, as well as they're going to start transferring other goods and everything throughout these dedicated freight corridors, will go a long way in actually reducing the cost of logistics throughout. I think an important component in this, and given the government's push in terms of not just road but rail as well, is the role that startups can actually play as part of this. We've already seen the rise of delivery and a number of them, delivery, Rippler, Let's Transport, and a number of them when it comes to road transportation itself. But when it comes to rail transportation and rail logistics, startups have a very, very small role to play as of now. So how would the railways actually go about engaging with startups, who allowing startups to actually start creating unique solutions in terms of digitization, as Reema spoke about, to actually help reduce the cost of logistics itself? I think that's a huge green field that will hopefully start emerging in some span of time. And all this is contingent on how well the railways actually want to play with this. Because Piyush Goyal, who's a railway minister, I believe, has actually been a long-standing supporter of startups in India as a whole. So the entire startup ecosystem is excited to see which new avenues that the railways actually open up for them as well.
So obviously, I believe till now, you know, there is a certain number of players who hog the entire systems of railways in terms of how they, transport goods. And the other part is that we've also, there was this long, pending, because we have not been able to complete the two dedicated freight corridors, which have already missed their deadline because of COVID, obviously. And now we have more, which have been announced. So this entire network, if you see, it connects the entire country. And as you said, that 14% as the cost of logistics is too high compared with any other country. So, do you think that there will be trickle down effects on any other sectors that are there? And if there are, which one be the most? And then I would also want to know from both of you that, we have let go of the physical fiscal deficit targets. So, and going to, them through borrowing. So do you think that in a way is a double-edged sword for the country, or was it the need of the hour?
So I can actually take that. I think number one, with regard to trickle-down effects for logistics, I think what we're going to start seeing is that the cost of goods that all of us actually purchase will actually go down to a large extent, because the logistics costs are ultimately baked into the MRP that all of us actually end up paying. So that translation of cost once logistics actually comes down will actually be hugely beneficial for all the customers and for all consumers itself. And this in turn, once the logistics costs actually go down, the ability and quality actually improves, of course, the ability for India to start actually exporting some of these goods itself, especially the perishable goods, will actually increase to a large extent. A large amount of agricultural produce happens in states of UP, which are actually extremely far from the coast as well. And all the transport usually happens to rail itself, which actually takes a prolonged period of time. Having those particular dedicated freight corridors can actually help take those raw materials all the way to the port, so they can start being exported throughout the world itself. So that trickle-down effect, I'm going to start seeing, not just in terms of logistics costs going down, but in terms of FMCG, in terms of agri-products, in terms of raw materials and inputs from manufacturing, all these costs will actually start going down to a large extent itself. And that's actually going to be hugely beneficial in terms of boosting trade. With regard to the FRBM and the fiscal policy, I think one of the most important things is to, Saurabh, is to understand that because of COVID, almost every single government across the entire world has unanimously started borrowing to a much larger extent. And some of them in the US especially have actually started printing money as well. Jeremy Powell has actually been extremely vocal about the fact that the government needs to actually spend as much in order to, you know, get out of this particular deficit. And we've also seen the finance minister acknowledge that India didn't go in for a big bang package. They actually had a series of surgical strike packages that they littered throughout the course of last year in order for specific industries as a whole. So I think it's a combination of these two. These two things have to be taken into light. The FRBM was conceived in a point in time where no one anticipated COVID actually happening. That's why they actually have situations and they have clauses over there which allow them to deviate from that. And if you look at India's fiscal deficit as a whole, India's fiscal deficit is close to 9%, and its debt in as a percentage of the GDP is actually far lower compared to a debt of literally any other country across. For Japan, it's about 250%. China's debt is also above its GDP, and similar with the US itself, where the total national debt is actually much. It's actually, I think, about 110 or 120% of the entire GDP as a whole. India's actually far lower, and that's actually good for the country. I think what the government should start doing, and this is something that they spoke about in the previous budget, is the fact that overseas borrowing of the government can actually start increasing. Because of the actions of the Federal Reserve in the US and the fact that interest rates across the entire world are actually at an all-time low, the ability for the government whose credit rating is actually improved to actually start borrowing from foreign sources should actually increase. This will reduce the domestic pressure. This will reduce the effect of the government has in terms of sucking up all the capital from the domestic markets. And this will actually start enabling firms and everyone to start borrowing within India at much lower cost of capital. I've often spoken about the fact that India's cost of capital, especially working capital, is inordinately high. And one of the reasons for that is that the government actually does a large amount of borrowings from the domestic markets itself. So when that sovereign rating, the government starts utilizing the provisions given in the last, budget 2020, and actually starts borrowing from abroad, I think they'll actually go a long way in cooling off the interest rates in the country. And with the transmission loss of interest rates hopefully being rectified by the RBI, and the recent Monetary Policy Committee has already spoken about that, we should hopefully see the cost of capital within the country reduced to a large extent.
And globally, it's now actually, if you see, is the fact it's negative. Nobody has, they don't have avenues to invest. So you can't, you are at a good time where the government can actually raise money outside India. The sovereign debt can easily go up. And, you know, today, if you look at it, the net borrowings is from 4 lakh crores. It's expected to go to 9 lakhs. And if there's going to be increase in growth, and then if you can also get debt from outside India, it's still manageable.
So we cited, US and other advanced economies, but with their currencies being more stable compared with India's, do you think that's what my question is, that, you know, is that an area which is of concern for us going forward? Maybe not this year, because we all expected the fiscal deficit to be let go of, and we were expecting it. It was expected.
Go ahead. No worries.
No, so as I was saying, Saurabh, see, a large amount of the currency depreciation that we've actually seen happen, that India has actually suffered, has actually been more or less stable. I think the current rate that all global markets expect is about a 4% currency depreciation on a yearly basis. So this has already been factored in, and the fact that a large amount of this ends up being hedged effectively will actually goes to ensure that they're protected against the fall in the currency, in the currency rate that usually happens. That becomes number one. Number two, I think it's also important to acknowledge the fact that because of the Federal Reserve's actions, there's a glut of US dollars across the entire world market as of now. Given that, you know, sudden increase in the availability of USD versus INR itself, there's some amount of stability that'll actually come in as part of that. That becomes number one. That becomes number two. Number three, the exports that India is actually going to see as of now, because the government has been speaking about exports and there've been a large number of export incentives that have already been created. And this in combination with the PLI scheme that the government has spoken about, and the need to actually decentralize your supply chains away from China and a large amount that's moving to India, we'll actually start seeing the foreign reserves in the country actually increase to a large extent. India has close to $555 billion of forex reserves with the RBI currently. And a large proportion of those foreign reserves, if you actually look at the balance sheet of the RBI, it's actually pegged at the conversion rate of $1 equal to, I think, about 50 rupees, if memory serves. That actually goes to show that India has a large amount of latitude when it actually comes to that. And the Indian currency depreciation is something that's already been factored. It's not something that's entirely new. And the change in the budget and change in the fiscal deficit is not in any meaning. It's not going to dramatically alter that particular currency rate itself, because it's not an isolated incident. It's a trend that's happening across the entire world. So that falling tide or that changing tide is going to affect all the countries unanimously. And India, because being more fiscally conservative, actually has a lower deficit and actually has a lower net borrowing compared to some of the other peers, not just across the world, but even in Southeast Asia itself. So this actually seen, that's how India has emerged as one of the net positive in terms of FDI compared to almost any of its peer countries in Asia during the course of COVID-19 itself.
Sure. So we've also been joined by Anirudh Damani. Welcome, Anirudh, as we sort of try to decipher how the budget 2021 has paved out. So first of all, you know, I've been asking everybody, how are you going to rate the budget this year? On a score of 20, how do you see it being there? And what is it particularly that you liked about the budget? Some particular policies that you think are going to sort of go a long way for the economy, but others which would not. One thing, of course, let me point out here is that there is a big, on the social media, it's being seen that since there have been no income tax policies being announced, nothing in reduction of income tax policy, which was expected because of increasing the consumer consumption in the country or increasing just buying capacity for the people at large, is something that people are extremely dissatisfied with. So maybe there's something also you might want to comment on.
So according to me, and before I give the rating, I think in this budget, the silence was the answer, right? They were silent on multiple different issues. There was expectation on the crypto ban to be announced over here. That did not happen. I think the government had a very, very difficult path to follow, and trying to keep everybody happy was definitely not that something they could have done, right? I mean, but what I really like about the budget was that the government said, you know what, we're going to have a 9.5% fiscal deficit. And guess what? We're not going to try to fix this for the next 5 years. So don't expect anything big over the next few years, which is going to increase the tax burden on the honest taxpayers. And I think that's a big decision. I think if the expectation was that India is going to, you know, bring an era of like low taxation for individual taxpayers right away, I think it's far-fetched, because we've had a very tough year, right? This has been as a government, this has been a year where they've had to like literally throw the budget and everything in the dustbin and go out there and spend, and which they have, right? And I think you're seeing the GST collections, 1.21 lakhs. I think the expectation this year is that the economy should grow 15%. So if you just extrapolate that into what GST revenues should be for that, I mean, this is going to be some really serious amount of dough in the hands of the states. And I think a lot of this, the government can do a lot on its own path. And I think they're spending money on healthcare. The healthcare spending is 137% higher, which is, you know, at an all-time high. They're spending money on infrastructure. I mean, this government has literally gone digital. They're saying even your tax assessments are now going to be done. I mean, your when you go to the tribunal, it's going to be done faceless. Now, as a startup, if you consider the government to be a startup, they're doing everything possible to go digital. So they put a very big message out there that digital is the future. They in fact even reduced audit for companies that do a 10 crore or more in turnover, and have at least 95% of your money should be digital. So I don't know where should I fault the government right now, right? Yes, I'm not 100% happy. Would I love to have them put another 20,000 crore into the fund of fund and then say, okay, you know what, we're going to start funding VC funds all the way up to 70%. Trust me, I would be dancing over here, and we would really be having a good time. But they didn't have the capital. But what is going to be the biggest positive that I deciphered here was that look at the number of taxpayers. You literally are saying that India added 1 lakh taxpayers per day over the last 12 months, right? So the number of taxpayers in the country, you know, to double. I mean, this has never happened ever, right? That way where this kind of tax compliance is going on. And I believe if we can continue this pace, you can expect an era of lower taxation over the next 3 to 4 years, right? But the government needs revenues. They're building this 90,000 crore, you know, Delhi Mumbai expressway that will reduce the time traveled to 12 hours, right? Which is a big intra project. I mean, they have to spend money on so many different things. And if our expectation is that the taxes are going to go down, what could they have done? Okay, maybe standard. The lower strata could have been at 3 lakhs instead of 2.5, I believe.
I do understand that the government needs revenues, but at the same time, business needs revenues too, to do some investments, to do some digital transformation of their own. Has the government taken that into account? Very quickly, Siddharth, Anirudh, both of you need to comment. Reema, please, as well.
Siddharth, you want to go first?
Yeah, go on.
No, I think Anirudh, you can go ahead.
No, I think the government, see, the government on its part is obviously going out there and spending money. Eventually, that money is going to trickle down to people like you and me, and then obviously to people that work with us, and so on and so forth. So I don't think the government has come short on that. They made it very clear they're going to spend a lot of money this year, and they're going to start building infrastructure. Infrastructure capital obviously is going to put thousands of people and millions of people to work. So according to me, yes. Now, how could they have put money back into the hands of the, so for that, I think they're just redefining how you would define a business, like the limit going from 50 lakhs to 2 crore. Those kind of small efforts are happening. I did not really expect a very big bang budget, because honestly, we've had 6 budgets in the last 12 months. If you look at it, right? Every Atmanirbhar thing was a budget. And then if you're expecting another big bang at the end of all of it, that's really expecting a lot. That being said, I do, here's what I believe. If there's going to be a 15% GDP growth this year, that is going to translate into business.
Isn't that right? A bit and above the top of 15% GDP growth?
I don't think so. I think it's going to be a lot of, we're already seeing the kind of massive supply buildup that's happening even today, right? And there is an expectation of a lot more FDI coming into the country. In this year, I would even say the VC ecosystem should probably see its best year ever, right? And you're going to see that, because this is the first time in history of India that the number of rural internet subscribers is higher than the number of urban internet subscribers. So you're going to actually see the consumption patterns of a large section of India that has never really been figured out on a digital level, right? 240 million, I think, some digital subscribers. And I was just doing a presentation last week for this family office conference. And at the start of 2020, right, India was at a 41% penetration of internet subscribers compared to China's 57%. China was at 41% about 8 years ago. As of, I think, September 2020, India is at 57% internet penetration. So literally, we took an 8-year gap and made it 9 months. Now, the impact of that is going to be seen. And I think, people like Siddharth and I are smiling, because I have a purple, he's got licious, right? And we're seeing the kind of trends coming out of this market. This is a lot of latent demand that was not available. It was available to the guys that had traditional distribution systems. Now it's available online. 99% of India's PIN codes had one delivery in the last 12 months. These are amazing, crazy, amazing numbers. This is exactly what Siddharth and I got into this business for, right? That we saw this happen one day. And I think we're literally underestimating the power of what that rural consumer is going to do to India. And plus the fact that Modi has spent an inordinate amount of money in the last 4 budgets on this rural population. So according to me, 15% is not far-fetched. It's definitely, you may be at 13 or 17, but it's not going to be, it is going to be double-digit here.
Ritu, I think one of the important parts to also keep in mind in this is to actually consider the lower base effect when they actually look at the GDP growth numbers as well, itself. 2020 actually seen the GDP of not just India, but basically every nation across the world, except China, actually reduce. So the moment we actually have any increase on a reduced base itself, the relative proportions of that is automatically going to increase. It's actually basic math that's actually going into it. So estimating a 15%, 50% growth or something in terms of GDP for India has not actually been far-fetched. We've seen the highest amount of tax collections in terms of GST being 1.12 lakh crores actually happen in January itself. And this is exactly just prior to the budget actually coming on board. And the fact that the government is actually now looking to actually increase the capital expenditure itself and actually help reduce the cost of logistics, help increase the penetration of urban housing when it comes to this, create a social security net for Indian gig workers. Everyone needs to emphasize the fact of what a monumental thing that actually is. This is similar to the fight that they're actually having in the UK, having in California, having in the US, all over the place as to what social security net can we actually create for gig workers. India has actually gone a step abroad and they've just put that as one line item in the entire budget itself. The wages code, the social security code, all this is going to start coming. And if you look at the government's budget, look at the speech itself, the fact that the private sector can start playing when it comes to railways, the fact that HRMS systems, for blue-collar workers in terms of compliance tech as well as rec tech, will actually become the mainstay for all businesses throughout in order for them to manage their labor compliances. These are new greenfield greenfield avenues are actually going to start increasing. The fact that your ITAT is actually going to start happening online, they're going to start having e-courts actually coming in itself. All these are new areas that the government is actually seeding, where entrepreneurs, once they can raise capital, can actually start building viable business models upon all these particular areas. So the government has actually seeded a large amount of work when it comes to this within the fiscal constraints that they're already suffering as of now. If you look at the every single government across the world has actually spoken about increasing the tax rates for certain individuals. The Indian government has been actually extremely charitable in the fact that they haven't actually gone and increased a particular tax rates as of now. I think that's actually the greatest sigh of relief across everyone, because some of the rumors coming out just prior to the budget, Ritu, I'm sure you've seen it, Anirudh has seen it, Saurabh has seen it, everyone on this call has seen it. Those are extremely alarming. If any of those actually came in at this point in time, you would have actually seen investor confidence actually shatter. And the moment investor confidence gets shattered, the ability for you to raise capital, ability for you to actually invest in your businesses and see this entire model play out, that particular trickle-down model play out, actually goes away. So the government, I think the government has to be commended on that. The 15% rate is something that will actually happen, because what most people are actually failing to acknowledge over here, Ritu, is the cost for a number of the businesses that are actually coming down significantly because they're allowed to actually work from home. And the digitization wave that's actually occurring. We looked at any of the bank provisions, you look at the December quarter results that have come out in the listed markets itself. All of them have actually managed to beat the speed expectations, because the normal cost centers they would normally incur have actually gone away. A large amount of that has now been diversified to all of us sitting at home as of now. So the moment those cost savings eventually go to the bottom line, and that actually gives them a large amount of money to actually start investing when it comes to that itself. So we have seen all this actually come into the fray. And India's strength has always been the digital economy. China's primary strength in terms of manufacturing, now that's actually changing as of now. So the government's putting a lot more into PLI as well as incentivizing manufacturing as a whole. But India's digital strength, innovation, and its assets can actually be taken throughout the entire world. And this is why Jio's managed to actually raise that absurd amount of money. We've seen the birth of about 6 or 7 unicorns happen during COVID itself.
Yeah.
The entire world is actually recognizing this entire portion, and there'll be startups and ambassadors who are actually going to ride this entire wave through. And that's something that I'm personally excited for. And that's something I'm sure Anirudh is excited for. Reema, who I think is also on this call, also be excited for itself. So all of us are now breathe a collective sigh of relief that we no longer have to go back and tinker, speak to our tax consultants and everyone to figure out what needs to be done as of now. We can actually concentrate on business, concentrate on investments, and actually start translating all this and actualizing the plans and the vision that the Prime Minister has articulated for all of us.
Sure. Anirudh, I mean, you know, there was supposed to be, and while of course, to some extent, the MSMEs have been included in the budget, but did you feel that particularly for family businesses and businesses which are into manufacturing in a large format, would the budget's going to make a big difference to them?
I think for manufacturing business, I think the erstwhile finance minister did bring it up that we currently already enjoy as a manufacturing business one of some of the lowest taxes in the world, right? And I think with GST and the things they're building towards infra. I did not see that this was probably neutral for them, but there's already enough positivity priced in for them in the past few years budget. So what I would have loved to see, and I think Siddharth was talking about it a little bit, was if there was a way to reduce the cost of borrowing was for businesses, right? Especially even startups. I mean, I'm a bit the other day one of our startups was just going for a working capital loan, and the net interest rate would have been working out to 21-22%. And that is just, then why not just raise equity? And that's concerning. When raising debt is almost equal to the price of raising a private equity round, right? It is a bit alarming. So to me, I would love to see the government come up with some sort of a plan. I think there's either an interest rate subvention or some sort of a way where the interest borrowing for at least a startup could be somewhere in at least the low 10 or the low double digits, right? Like a 10, 11, 12%. And then that would really get things going. To just add one thing that I really think we've missed and missed multiple budgets, is the way the government grew the solar industry, right? The initial solar developers, they got tax benefits for investing into solar. And if you look at, where wind and solar got in a very short period of time, it was literally fueled by these tax incentives. In fact, UK has a pretty large tax incentive for corporates to invest into startups. So I continue to believe that the government needs to have some sort of a allocation or allow HNIs and family offices and to invest into other businesses and allow that to be a tax reduction, right? And it could be, and that could even help them invest into downstream businesses, right? That could help them with their with the original business plan. I mean, it could help HNIs participate into more HNIs and more family offices participate into the space. There could be a cap. It could be like a crore a year. It could be 10 crore. That's not really the thing. But I think that our ecosystem needs more liquidity, right? A lot of the capital that fund managers like myself have had to raise has been from abroad and not from India. And then that means that all the startup wealth we create eventually then goes out, to investors not living here, right? So how can we change that? We need to encourage and provide more incentives for that kind of investment to happen at the lower end and not to keep parking the money into the equity mutual fund. I think that is something that government has been missing for the past few years. I don't know why they keep extending startup tax benefits. I'm yet to know which startup is actually availing of those benefits. Most of the time you're building in that phase, right? So to me, I think that's a trick we keep missing. If there was a way for even CSR funds, something where that money could get put into startups either through VC funds or directly into DIPP approved startups, that could be a real it could really create a massive amount of pool of money for startups to go out and raise from, right? And could also encourage more super angels to become fund managers. I think that's a trick we've been missed for 2-3 years now.
Sure. Reema, do you have any thoughts on the same on how small businesses, MSMEs are likely to get some mileage out of this budget?
I do think that this would, because one is the fact that they've increased the size of the MSME, this itself. It's now up to 2 crores, a 20 crores investment. So that itself will extend this to benefit to a lot more of the SME space and startup spaces as well, right? Because a lot of companies do raise less than 20 crores money. So this would benefit them is one thing. And the moment you have more privatization happening in the banking sector, I think this itself would be of a great benefit as one thing. While technically the nationalized banks were supposed to lend to, especially in the agri sector and all, they were supposed to lend, we actually found very little money trickled through. But with the nationalization, I was just talking to one private sector bank. They said, in fact, they do find that if the governance is getting improved, and if you're going to have a lot more compliances being happening, there's no reason why they would not lend to the sector. So I do think that this would open up for the MSME sector is one thing. And with the gift and all coming through, I think that we're going to see, yes, but I agree with Anirudh. I got dropped off because of bad connectivity, but I do think that we would still continue to see a lot more of foreign capital coming into the country. Than domestic capital. I heard part of what Anirudh said, but I do think that this would continue to happen. And it's, I think it's a good thing, especially if you see the insurance sector, if it's opening up to 74%, it would.
Looks foreign like
capital coming in. Yeah.
Sure. Punita?
So Reema, the government, when it announced about the OPC, when Indian citizens who are living abroad, non-resident Indians, they can also set up new incorporations. Do you think that's a big move and we're going to see more NRIs looking forward to it and then setting up companies this way?
Are you asking this to anyone?
Yeah, I think it just got dropped off too.
Oh, okay. Siddharth, Anirudh, would you like to
take that? Yeah, sure. I think, Punita, see, the OPC, the one-person company structure is not actually a structure that's conducive for Indian entrepreneurs who are actually looking to raise capital. Because the purpose of a one-person company is only be one shareholder, right? So the moment you actually have to go raise money from an angel investor or a VC or any other kind of investor, you automatically have to translate your corporate structure from an OPC to a private limited company, which is usually in vogue itself. So I think The OPC part is not as much for funded startups. I think the OPC will actually go a long way in helping in helping corporatize sole proprietorships will actually be the primary beneficiary of this. So a person running a small trading concern, a small trading store or a department store or something can actually opt for the OPC structure, and because of the rationalization in terms of minimum shareholding, except not minimum shareholding, maximum amount of capital you can actually raise, what sort of revenue, etc., all that going away. The ability for them to actually create a corporate wrapper to ring fence liability and to actually get access to working capital as well as enter into the formal sector will actually help bolster the MSME sector to a very large extent. But for VC funded startups, the OPC change will actually have a very negligible effect as a whole.
Okay, and the way it mentions that, okay, when OPC can easily
get other parts of that entity.
Go on, please.
I was just going to add to what, I was going to talk about OPC when my line got disconnected. The other area where the OPC would help is basically with innovation. So there are a lot of innovators who have innovation, but who are not in the corporate structure. And for them to get, whether it's grants or for them to get some kind of debt becomes very difficult. So the OPC structure is expected to help with a lot more from capital coming in from institutions like BIRAC and all that. So BIRAC has just, in fact, was on the call in one of the earlier calls where they expect that the OPC is going to benefit a lot of scientists who are looking to corporatize their innovation.
It could also lead to a segregation between personal and corporate liability, which becomes a big problem.
Absolutely. That's what Saurabh touched upon.
Sure, Saurabh. Yeah, so it's very pretty amusing to see that after a budget, no one has complaints about the budget, and we are saying that we don't have to actually say what the government could have done. But still, on some points, there have been silence, as was mentioned by Siddharth. And Anirudh, you touched upon the cryptocurrency part. And of late, we saw a lot of investment going into, crypto-based startups. So I have not gone through the entire financial budget, but I'm assuming that it's not there. So is the silence good or bad for these? Because I was getting, reactions from a lot of people that they would want to be stakeholders in the discussion if something called a private crypto is done by the country. So what do you read of that?
No, I think the silence on that, again, the entire budget parliament session is also not over, so they could always introduce a bill to ban it, and there was some talk about that as well. But I'm hoping that does not happen. However, we need, the problem with crypto is that, and in a country like India where we have too many enemies, internal and external, right? Especially on the terrorism front, is that the anonymity of the transaction, is what the problem has really been. How do you track if there's terror funds being, and they've been, it's not to say that this network has not been utilized in the past for terror. So in that sense, I think an RBI issued digital coin would make sense. In fact, one of the most popular coins today is the USDT, right? Which is basically a cryptocurrency where whatever amount that is of the value of the currency is, it say that about $1 to every every coin, but they have the exact amount of the volume that they have, the exact amount of that is available in a bank account. Now, whether someone's auditing that or not, I'm not getting into that, but it is supposed to be equal to the amount of dollars in their bank account. Could India have a rupee coin that does the exact same thing? Why not? It would definitely help with convertibility between coins. So that could be an RBI issued coin. That could be pretty interesting. However, I think India continues to blanket rejects the entire crypto space. I think that could be very negative for startups. Many of them have gotten funded recently, and they've raised lots and lots of capital with the intention that we're not going to have to see this policy overhang on it. So I would hope that the government comes up with some sort of a solution, right? Because honestly, I've been negative on the India crypto space. I've made some investments outside India, but in India, I've not really made any crypto investments because of this, because there's no clarity. And this is not a space where I can take, an RBI-related risk. This is going to be a FEMA-related risk, and I don't want to get on to that bandwagon at this stage of my career.
Mm. Okay, Andrew, I think you want to leave. So, before you go, was this really a never before like budget for you? Do you think so?
considering the reaction, never before. But that, we're all confused,
you
right?
Still debate it.
Yeah. But I think Ritu asked a question earlier on ranking it. I would probably rank it, considering all the factors, about a 16 out of 20. Right? It's definitely not a home run, but I think considering everything they had, the fact that they did not tinker with any of the taxes, I think that itself would be 10 points right there, right? And they could have taxed the rich even more and driven them out of the country if possible, but. They did not, right? And they've taken a path that, listen, this is going to take some time, and we'll recover and we'll spend money together. Happy about that.
Thanks, Anirudh. Thanks for joining
us. Thank you, everybody.
Siddharth, in terms of what Saurabh was asking, in terms of what is not there in the budget. So would you like to sort of comment on that?
All the asks of the entire startup industry, not a single one of them turned up in the budget. I think I wholeheartedly can say that. The fact that ESOP taxation, whatever tinkering they did to Section 156 last year, there's been numerous representations. I think the Piyush Goyal also went on the record to say that, in case anyone has any suggestion to make on that, please write to us. Numerous people have written. I personally have 4 to 5 papers on that. Exactly. And there's been almost no change when it comes to that particular portion whatsoever. The tax rate rationalization between listed and unlisted securities, that hasn't actually been addressed to a large extent. The large amount of compliance cholesterol that all startups actually have to do. Startups, if you actually look at it, have to do close to about 200 separate pieces of compliance in the ordinary course of business. This in terms of labor management, ESI, PF, taxes, GST, indirect, MCA, everything else. And this excludes one-off events like raising capital, issuing ESOPs and all this other part. None of that's actually been addressed by the government so far. The fact that there are distortions in the tax structure, in the corporate structure between LLP and a company also, that hasn't been rationalized by them as well. So numerous asks, and this is excluding the investor portion. Investors have an entire laundry list of stuff that they also need to get through, but I'll keep the startup issues itself. So a large amount of, none of that's actually been addressed by them. We've seen two things happen to startups: increase in the tax window that's supposed to come through. That's been number one, as well as for investments into startups, certain kind of startups. These two, there are only 400 companies in the entire country who can actually avail of these particular two transactions. That's a very small number compared to 50,000. So that hasn't done much for startups as a whole. So I think the lesson that startups have got from this is they need to become Atmanirbhar themselves, not rely on the government to actually give them any softs or any changes or anything like that, but to sort of capitalize upon the avenues that the government is opening up to them as of now, and actually start building up their businesses in a more organic fashion.
I mean, I think that's what it is. Finally, it would need to be is the fact that you're creating a more enabling environment where there is, where there is demand being created, where there is overall growth. See, when there is an economy is growing, then you have opportunities for everyone, right? And so the tax, you don't need to increase the percentage of tax, your revenues will swell on its own. So I think as long as the economy is growing, it grows at 15%, I think there's nothing more that the startups would need to ask for. Yeah, but that doesn't mean, of course, like all the things that are there as the startups, especially at, around the ESOPs and then a lot around the investors that we have been petitioning the government for, would all be required. But I think those are smaller things in the overall scheme of things. If the growth is there, I think two things that have been stood out. One is the fact that the fact that the tax rates didn't go up kind of gave an immediate euphoria to almost everyone, because everyone was expecting it. So it was almost like, you were expecting the bus to come and hit you, and the bus stopped 10 meters away is like how everybody has been. And so essentially, I think that's the euphoria that is there. But on the other hand, the growth, if it can, because infrastructure can create a lot of growth. And this push, the digitization and infrastructure push itself, could create a growing economy, and that would possibly help everyone.
So what is your take on what kind of employment generation should come out of this infrastructure outlay that has been created?
So one is direct infrastructures in terms of the employment that it gets created, but then the trickle-down effect on whether it is all capital goods creation will all go up, right? I mean, so whether it is in terms of steel, whether it is in terms of the machinery manufacturers, all of them are going to have a direct impact. And then all the stops being done for the agri infrastructure, for example, would mean money going into the rural economy. So which in turn would mean demand for FMCG goods, white capital goods. So it's essentially, it's at every, you could, then you would have a trickle down employment effect that gets created. So at any point of time, infrastructure and capex can create a huge impact in terms of employment generation over a period, direct and indirect together.
Sure. Any thoughts on what the insurance sector, the changes that you also look to see in the insurance sector, particularly in the insurtech side, given the fact that there has been a push to the insurance sector in the budget?
So this is in the face of it, while it says is a 74%, and most of the initial reaction that I've heard from the insurance sector is that they're unlikely to go up beyond 51-52%. They're not people sitting in the except for insurance companies from Japan is what who have reacted positively saying that they would like to take it up. But otherwise, most of them are only looking for the fact would they get to 51-52% at least, because they would need to have management control. So I think, so from that perspective, there's unlikely to be huge monies coming in from the insurance sector. It just creates a more positive environment for the sector itself. And that, it could open up in future, but may not have an immediate impact, is what I heard some comments coming in as the thing came up. But what it does is the fact that, we are so underinsured, right? I mean, in terms of the percentage, that if we could, the more the insurance sector scales up, it's the opportunity is huge, right? I mean, I don't have the percentages. Right. Unlike Siddharth, I'm not able to rattle off the percentages, but fact is that the insurance sector is huge, right? And so I think that is going to be a big opportunity.
And then LIC itself is going public this year, so.
Absolutely. But that being the fact that, the insurance startups is just picking up. You've barely scratched the surface. And none of them have gone beyond the already insured population, and they haven't gone beyond that, and they've just about started scratching to the next billion users in the country. And once you start reaching out to all of them, healthcare has obviously had a huge push in health tech insurance in this during the COVID period, and it's obviously going to go up, right? And so a large part of the healthcare insurance or the government healthcare insurance is around 13,000 crores is likely to go into that. So all those will give those push to that insurance industry. And obviously, hopefully in the long run, you will also see more FDI come into that sector.
Sure. Insurance, Siddharth?
Those barriers being there, like when initially 74%, I mean, the fact it was 49% was apparently a psychological barrier for many companies. Because sure. Then it felt you could go up to 49%, but still not have control. And so the fact that you could cross that itself and get to 50-51% is a big thing. And that's likely to create the changes, what it is. Yeah. And even if it's not an immediate one.
Any numbers you want to share on the insurance side?
No, I think the insurance penetration. So LIC alone actually sees about 5 lakh crores of premium actually flow through it, which actually commands close to about 65% of the entire insurance sector of the country as of now. I think that's actually one of the biggest. That just shows how ripe for disruption the entire insurance sector actually is. We've actually seen a number of rounds in the insurance tech space also open up. And this happened not just from early stage companies, but all the way to much, much larger companies as well. So insurance as a whole, I think, and what COVID has done as a behavioral aspect is to sort of educate people about the need for insurance, because no one knows when these sort of force majeure events can actually happen. And the fact that everyone actually overestimates the sort of financial cushion they can actually have to actually weather through those particular storms. So I think insurance is something that's now been ingrained into everyone's, into the psyche across all people. And the space is actually ripe for disruption itself. And we've seen, if you actually notice the number of insurance companies in the country, you can actually count them on your hand itself. That's how few that entire space is. And for a country of 1.3 billion people to only be served by such a small number of insurance companies actually goes to show how the amount of latitude that actually exists within this entire space as a whole. So while the insurance FDI going up is actually a very positive move, the Insurance Act of 1936 or 1938 that the country that's currently in vogue in the country as of now actually needs large-scale reforms to come through. Because if we actually look at it, the sort of investment patterns they can possibly pursue it severely impaired and impeded compared to what the global peers already have. And even though the government, the finance minister hasn't spoken about this, the head of IRDA as well as even the pension funds and everyone have actually spoken about the need to actually start rationalizing this to a large extent and enabling them to actually start investing in a manner that would can help increase and enhance the returns for the premium holders as well as the contributors. Because see, the era of high growth across the entire world is actually gone. Growth rates across the entire world have actually plummeted. So the ability for these insurance companies to actually start making positive returns in a low growth environment is extremely impeded. So it behooves them and the regulators to actually start increasing the number of avenues they can to actually invest to ensure they can actually make good on those particular claims as and when they come around. So that's something that investors have been speaking about, insurance regulators have been speaking about, but the finance minister has been unfortunately mum on that as of now. They only increased the FDI rate. But hopefully with this FDI rate, we should see some more rationalization coming through IRDAI, and hopefully all these regulations also change during the course of this year itself.
That I don't expect to change because from the last IRS number, that is expecting too much, I think. It's unlikely to go change.
All of us can only hope right now.
But the other thing is that, you know, the consumer behavior change is what is the more, hopefully that will open up far more opportunities because the fact that, like what Siddharth said, consumer at least now appreciates the need for insurance. And so that behavior change is what will open up the sector a lot more, I think.
Well, with this, I'm going to thank Siddharth and Reema for joining us
today. Thank you
so much for your wonderful inputs. And I think that was a great description of the industry and the opportunities that you've panned out. And hopefully we're looking for this 2021 to be much better, bigger, and particularly for VCs to be doing a lot more in making the economy go all bang on. Thank you again for joining us.